Olá, hoje o programa Arqueologia em Ação tem como convidado o professor Dr. Ethan Cochrane e ele vai falar sobre a arqueologia da Polinésia e os assentamentos da América do Sul. So, thanks, Ethan, for receiving us and for conceiving this interview. First of all, I would like to ask you if you can tell us what are you doing here in Brazil and what do you work in archaeology?
In archaeology, I work at the University of Auckland, and one of the professors in the museum, Astolfo Araujo, he and I have known each other for a long time, we're colleagues, and he invited me to come to Brazil to present a class on theory in archaeology, theory and classification, and how we explain things in archaeology. Maybe when people like, maybe your mom, goes into a museum, right? And you read the small card on the museum and it says things like, people use these stone tools 10,000 years ago to do this or that. How do we know that's true? How do we, you know, the little cards in the museum, how do we know that that's, how do we know that? How can we say that? So part of the class is just about that. Teaching students and talking about how we come up with those answers in archaeology. So other people maybe can know more about the past and about the archaeological record by understanding how we can say those things. So that's why I'm here.
Okay, so do you work with Polynesia? Can you tell us what's the region delimited by Polynesia?
Yeah. Yes, I work in Polynesia, and well, it's complicated because Polynesia is a region that was defined by people from outside, by actually some first the Portuguese, the Spanish, Europeans. The British, these people came to the Pacific Islands, sailing around, all around the Pacific Islands, many times in the 1700s, the 1800s. And so before Europeans came, there was no Polynesia, there was just lots of islands. But Europeans, they went to places like Hawaii and Rapa Nui, or Easter Island, where the big stone heads are, that's very famous, and New Zealand, where I live. And all the islands in between, and they noticed that people all spoke very similar languages. So from Hawaii in the north, to Easter Island in the east, to New Zealand in the south, it's a big triangle, and all the islands in the middle, Samoa, Tahiti, Rarotonga, Marquesas, all those islands in the middle, everyone there looks very similar, and they all speak very similar languages. So for example, the word for house in Hawaii is hale. In Samoa, fale. In New Zealand, fare. So in those places, they're separated by maybe 6,000 kilometers between those places. So the word Polynesia is, in the region, is delimited by that triangle of Hawaii, Easter Island, New Zealand. And inside that triangle are Samoa, Tonga, Cook Islands, Tahiti, Marquesas, and others, Australis, Tuamotus. So that's the region, and it's defined by people looking very similar and culturally being very similar.
Okay, and what are the oldest dates for present human in Polynesian territories?
The oldest dates for people in Polynesia. Well, if you think about that triangle, and to the west of that triangle are other islands, places like Fiji, New Caledonia, Vanuatu, Papua New Guinea. People entered Polynesia from the west, from that place. So the earliest time they made it to Polynesia was 3,000 years ago, Samoa and Tonga. And they stayed in Samoa and Tonga for 2,000 years. And then 1,000 years ago, they went to the Cook Islands, Tahiti, Hawaii, Rapa Nui, New Zealand, all very quickly. So this side, the west side of Polynesia, people first there were first there 3,000 years ago. Then it took another 2,000 years, as I said, before they burst out to everywhere else. And before then, even over here in the west, people were there for, in some places, 40,000 years. So it's a kind of 40,000, 3,000, 1,000.
So there are many cultures in Polynesia. Are they related to each other?
Yes, they are. As I said, they're related through languages. So we know people speaking similar languages. They're related, people are related biologically. They look very similar. I mean, there's differences, but they look similar. And they are also related in terms of material culture, maybe artifacts, you might say, right? For example, I said about languages, how they're all related. In terms of material culture, so do you know of on Easter Island, the giant stone statues, right? Many people think that those are, well, they are, they're very unique, and they are, you know, they're fantastic, they're amazing. Other islands in Polynesia also have big stone statues that look like people, but they're much, maybe they're this tall, they're much smaller. But in the Marquesas, they have giant stone statues, but again, like maybe this tall. In places like Hawaii, they have statues, but they're made out of wood, but they look very similar. So we know that people in Polynesia were going back and forth between the islands, and they were making the same kinds of things. And so we know they were talking to each other is one way to put it. So yes, there's similar artifacts, very similar languages, similar biology. There's various genetic variation that has been investigated that shows these people are all related. And it all points to people coming from the West as a group.
Okay. And do you believe that people from Polynesia has come to South America through navigation in...
Yes, yes. I mean, okay.
Early Holocene?
Early Holocene. Let's see, do I believe? Yes, I think I paused because it's not a choice of whether I believe it or not. It's what does the evidence say? And the evidence thus far says yes, Polynesians made it to South America. I believe the weight of the evidence indicates that. Primarily, that is because there is a vegetable, the sweet potato. I think in many South American languages, it's kumar. And kumar, which are from maybe northern Chile, is where there's many native potatoes there. There are no native potatoes to Polynesia or anywhere more to the west. They don't exist. However, in archaeology, we know that sweet potato is found in Polynesia beginning about 1200 AD. And so it has to come from South America. We know from a particular region in South America where it came from based on sweet potato genetics, that is northern Chile. The word for sweet potato in all of those Polynesian languages, it's the same word as in South America. So it's a very different word from any Polynesian language. It's like the French, they say le t-shirt, right? T-shirt. We know that's not a French word, but they've adopted that word for their own. Or we all say tsunami, which is a Japanese word. But everyone, we all say the word tsunami, so we've taken that word into our language. The same with kumar. In Polynesian languages, the word is sometimes kumara, sometimes kumala, but it's, so the word comes from South America, as does the potato itself comes from South America. Now, there's been simulations and experiments suggesting that sweet potatoes, to grow them, you usually do not use seeds. You cut the top off the sweet potato and you put it in the ground, right? So people have, could a sweet potato have floated over from South America to Polynesia? The chances are very, very minimal, no. It wouldn't survive the months in salt water and be able to come up on the land and then grow. Also, people have done simulation experiments with ocean currents. And if you put sweet potatoes in the water in Chile, they go up to Mexico. They don't go to Polynesia. So the fact that sweet potato is from South America, we find it in Polynesia at the same time that Polynesians got to Polynesia, and Polynesians could also go up back and forth through all these islands. We know they were able to travel around a lot, so they were really good voyagers. Sweet potato is here, The name is the same. Sweet potatoes could not have come over on their own, and it had worked. So the kind of logical conclusion is that Polynesian navigators made it to South America, got the sweet potato, and came back. That's the simplest explanation.
But we can think the opposite, that South American people went to Polynesia Island during the same?
Yes, you could. You could think that. I mean, yes, that's a possibility. But when you consider the kind of huge amount of evidence that Polynesians are expert navigators, right? We know they were expert navigators because they were able to colonize all of Polynesia within maybe 200 years. If you think about, they went from Samoa to Tahiti, that's maybe 2,000 kilometers. They went from Tahiti to Hawaii, 3,000 kilometers, and back. They went back and forth. They went to Aotearoa, sorry, that's another name for New Zealand, Aotearoa. They went there and back. We know this because there are basalt tools from Hawaii, and we can tell they're from Hawaii based on geochemistry. Those basalt tools are found in Tahiti. So we know they were able to go back and forth. So we know that Polynesian navigators were specialists in navigation. So that suggests that they're the ones who made it to South America and came back instead of South Americans. Sure, it's possible. And even Thor Heyerdahl, he demonstrated you could drift from South America to Polynesia, but he had to be towed 50 kilometers offshore in a motorboat, and he made it to islands called the Tuamotus, but he was almost dead. Whereas Polynesians had the ability to go pretty much anywhere they want to anytime. So again, all that evidence suggests that it's the Polynesians who made it to South America and not the South Americans who made it to Polynesia. Maybe some South Americans came back, but Polynesians were the navigators in that story.
And what about the material culture from those places? Are they similar?
They're similar in some very, I say, small, unique instances. For example, there is stonework in Rapa Nui, these big stone platforms that the statues sit on. And the stones are very nicely carved to fit, right? And you see the same thing in Chile, in Moche cultures. You see the same kind of stone carving. But you also see the same kind of stone carving in China, in North America, in Egypt. In other words, if you're going to build a platform, you've got to carve stones. And so that similarity is similar all over the world, right? So there are some small similarities like that. But they're more easily, I think, more logically explained as just similar. People do similar things all over the world, and it does not mean they were in contact with one another.
Okay, yeah. In your opinion, what is the most interesting discovery? No. In your opinion, what is the most interesting archaeological study about Polynesia?
What needs to be done? What we can do? Or what has been done?
Yeah.
It's a huge area of research, so difficult to say the most interesting. There's, I think, maybe two things. One is the tracking that movement of people across islands, being able to chart the movement of people from Samoa to Tahiti to wherever, using multiple techniques. So we use languages to tell us about contact. We use the transfer of things like, as I said, basalt stone tools. We can tell they come from Hawaii, but we find them in Tahiti, so we know they were taken there. And a very interesting set of analyses are genetic, but they're the genetics of rats. It's kind of strange, but rats are also, there's a particular species of rat, Rattus excellens. It's called the Polynesian rat. It's a little small, cute guy, not the big, ugly rats. And we find them in archaeological sites. Rattus excellens goes with people on their canoes. Maybe not on purpose, but you know they stow away. And the first archaeological deposits in all of these islands, they also have this kind of rat in them. And we know that rats didn't have little rat boats, right? They're little sailboats. And so we can do the genetics of rats. We take rat bones from Hawaii, rat bones from Tahiti, rat bones from New Zealand, and we compare the genetics of them. And in that way, it's the same as comparing the genetics of people. Because in this instance, we know that rats equal people, because the rats had to have gotten there with people. So we can track the, where did people come from? In New Zealand, where did they come from? Well, we know they came from the Cook Islands, which is in central Polynesia. And we know people from Polynesia came from further to the west, places like Fiji and New Guinea, because the rats show that trail through their genetics. So it's pretty interesting that using all those techniques to track the movement of populations. There's many more questions to be asked, though. How often did people move? Interestingly, when Europeans came to Polynesia they first came in the 1600s, but that was more in a place called Micronesia. Europeans came to Polynesia a lot in the 1700s and 1800s. And at that time, Polynesians were no longer voyaging. They were no longer going from island to island. So they had no technology for those vast distances that they moved. They couldn't do that anymore. But they used to be able to. So a question is, why did that stop? Why did Polynesians stop voyaging all over the Pacific Ocean? No one's been able to answer that. So that's an interesting question.
Okay, that was my last question. You can say something for us that is important to study, and nobody has done that.
Well, yeah, but that is one. I mean, there's more than that. Another example is that it's somewhat complicated, but in Polynesia, I said people first got to Samoa and Tonga. Those are two islands which are very close. They're right next to each other. They got there 3,000 years ago, and then they stayed there for 2,000 years, and then they went to Tahiti, Marquesas, and those other islands. The first people to get to Samoa and Tonga, they probably did not have the same kind of genetics or language or artifacts. But then when they left 2,000 years later to go to Polynesia, the rest of Polynesia, they had similar genetics, similar artifacts, similar languages. So how did that happen? How do you have a very diverse group or a potentially diverse group of people? How do they become more, in English the word is homogenous, more the same before they went out into Polynesia? And why? Why did that happen? So no one, there's lots of potential answers, and that's part of the research I work on, but we haven't figured it out yet. So that is something that needs to be addressed.
So I want to thank you for the interview and your explanations for us, and to come to Brazil and tell us about the importance of archaeology and other kinds of point of view. E por hoje só.
'Archaeology costs money, right?
Yep.
All this university, and it costs money. And it also, people maybe not realize this, but if you do commercial archaeology, you know, when they build a road, they can't just put the bulldozers through an archaeological site, right? They have to excavate it and analyze the site and learn about it. That costs money too. I mean, it costs the public money. Because archaeology costs the public money, the public has the right to demand good knowledge, to demand that archaeologists produce knowledge that is useful and interesting and relevant and long-lasting, and not just someone's opinion, which may at some point next year, 20 years later, no one agrees with. So because it costs money, the public should demand kind of sound knowledge from that. So that's one thing I think maybe that people should know about archaeology, that it's possible to do that. And so we should try to, that's what we should try to do.